Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the creation of my Real Self question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentation, The Creation of My Real Self. Recorded on the 10th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay, so the title of this session is The Creation of My Real Self Q&A. Here's the opportunity to ask some more questions. And you'll notice there's quite a lot of the outline that I haven't covered, so you may want to ask specific questions about the things I haven't covered. So let's fire away, shall we? Let's start with Paul on this side. We'll go back to Canaan behind. Start at Sherry on this side. Come down to Laura. Paul.
As it's our addictions which repel our soulmate, mostly. On a physical level, with the vortexes that our spirit body, I think, is sending out and wanting to bring in. What happens if we're not engaging in those addictions?
They're still there. They're still coming out. You can engage them. But the only way you've got, the only way you can correct it is removing them. You want to remove the vortexes. And how are the vortexes that, you know, you said, oh, it's our addictions or a facade that prevents the awareness of a soulmate. It's not actually. It's your pain. Your facade adds to the problem, but it's your pain that actually causes the problem. Your pain is the creation of the vortexes that are going in and out of you, right? So it's your pain that's a part of the problem. Now, you can see that to get to the pain requires a process, and that process has to be engaged. So unless we engage the process where we actually start getting down to our pains, and particularly the pains associated with our intergender relationships, you know, what happens with between males and females, unless we get to that, it's highly unlikely we'll see the other half of ourselves, and therefore highly unlikely we'll know who we are as a complete soul. So it's like that.
For me, it's a fear of the woman, and also the hurt from the woman and the absence of love.
Well, that you're assuming it's that, Paul. And this is a problem for many of you, is you're not here yet. Remember, you're here. You haven't even accepted this yet. Unless you accept this, you're going to start assuming it. You have a whole heap of feelings, some of which you have and some of which you don't have, right? You're not going to know what the feelings are until you get to the feelings and actually feel them. And this is where I see a lot of you jumping ahead. You're wanting to jump ahead just rather than recognizing where you're at. So the reason why we're sharing this real self stuff with you is so that you recognize that this isn't your real self. It's very important you see none of this is your real self. Because if you keep seeing it as your real self, you're going to hold on to it. And that's no good for you. It's no good for anybody to hold on to that. So we need to show you what our real self is, contrast what the real self is with this, so that you've at least got some intellectual awareness that, you know, what I'm aiming for was to get my addictions met with the other half, and really that's nothing to do with my real self. You need to be able to have that awareness, you see. So, yeah, it's very important you see that it's the pain that, unless you get to this pain, you won't actually be able to open up to the other half of yourself. And unless you get to this pain, it's highly unlikely emotionally that you're ever going to really recognize the other half of yourself. So you can see the essential, it's really essential to get to this pain. And you notice that there's some people who've thought that they're other halves themselves, and sometimes they even get confirmation that they are. But when they engage a relationship, they split up within a very short time. And why is that? It's because they're unwilling to get rid of this. And so after a while, they don't even believe the very person I've met who they believe was the other half at the beginning. Once they start trying to engage their addictions with that half and it doesn't work, then they go, oh, I'm going to chuck that person away. They're not meeting my real demands and my real needs. Do you know what I mean? Just that's what we do. Many of you have done that already. You've thrown away the other half of yourself. without even knowing. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. We next was Canaan behind, and Sherry is on this side.
So I feel like super excited to hear about soulmates, but on the flip side, I don't want to open my heart. I frequently attack Steve, all this kind of thing. So is it because in my facade, I'm feeling like this creation, discovery of my real self is...
You're only super excited because it meets some of your addictions, Sherry.
That's what I was asking.
You're not really excited.
No.
Really, okay. You're scared. You're freaked out to the max about it.
Okay.
Does that make sense? And that comes out in your relationship. That's why you don't want to open your heart.
Mm.
This is why you have to release some of the pain to recognize the other half, because your heart is involved in your pain at the moment. For all of you, when you've got pain, your heart's involved in it. You believe that to be you and how you really feel. And that then the vortexes drive your behavior, right? So when you say you like the idea, for many of you, when you first heard the concept of soulmates, you loved the idea, but only for some addictive reasons. That's all. You're addicted to the concept without understanding it. You're addicted to the concept or idea that somebody's going to be the ideal you, and they'll magically come along with a white horse and you'll fall magically in love and everything will be rosy thereafter. What a crock of bullshit. I know that's pretty crass, but that's what it is. It's just total crap. Right, and I understand why the average person on the planet who's a bit more intellectually developed goes, well, that's total crap, you know, because it is. It's like, it's just what you wish to have happen. That's completely different to what God's created. And that is the desires of our addictions.
Mm-hmm.
So it's our addiction to have some magical thing come along, magical person come along. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. We were over here at Canaan. Yeah.
So you said about, I know this is a bit like further ahead of all of us, but I'm like the soul union state on earth.
Yep.
I was just wondering, how would that like look physically? I know it hasn't happened or anything, but...
Well, because it hasn't happened, it's very hard to predict what it's going to look like physically. I have some ideas of what it might potentially look like.
Yep.
But it's very, very hard to say, you know, what it's going to look like, you know, and also whether it actually physically happens will depend upon probably the survival of some of the 14 in the long term to develop to that point again, because they'll be the most easily able to develop to that point after they've become at one with God, and because they already remember how to do it, right? It was already done for them anyway. They're already in a union state. All they've got to do is get a memory of that state, basically. So Mary and I are already in the union state, and Courtney and his soulmate are already in the union state. So there's the separation is only caused by the choices that were made here. That's all it's caused by. Once the 14 remove all of this, then the consciousness of the union state will also appear, and they'll be able to be in the union state and develop and demonstrate to you what it looks like on earth.
Yeah.
Right? But we don't really know what it looks like, because nobody's ever done it in a physical form. Right? We know what it looks like in the spirit world, but not here.
Could I ask another follow-up question from
you? Sure.
So, like, because you've been in...
If you hold a bit closer.
You've been in a 36 sphere state before. When you remove all your blockages, you'll automatically be in that state again? Like, just like, boom.
I think so.
Yeah, okay.
But no one's done that on earth to know.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm assuming so.
Yeah.
My awareness is developing now to the point where I'm starting to become aware that once this state is removed, there will be a transfer. The feelings I have at this stage are that there'll once the at-one-ment state with God is reached for one half of the soul, then that half of the soul will go through a process where information from the soul can now be transferred to the spirit body's brain, bearing in mind it's a brand new spirit body that's not had that development. So from a person who's in a union condition, it's a bit different from you for your development. So imagine Mary and I in that state, right? In a union state. Mary and I both do not have a conscious awareness of that state because of this, the sin. You follow? Once the sin is removed, the effects of the sin is removed, then the first person who does that, whether it's myself or Mary, doesn't matter, the first person who does that obviously will be in the spirit body's mind, will now be aware of that complete union state. Does that make sense? But for us, this body is a newly created body in this life. It's not the same as you. For you, your soul is developing with its body. For us, our soul has already been developed, but our bodies don't know about it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And we have to remove why it don't know about it, which is all to do with this. All the sin that's now come as a part of coming back to the planet has all occurred and been pushed upon these bodies, and so therefore the awareness isn't developed. Once the awareness is developed, the body, this soul, can transmit information to the mind of the spirit body, and then of course to the brain of the physical body. Does that make sense? So what I think will happen, and I don't know because it's never been done before, but I think will happen is once I remove the blockages to receiving that information, then that information will just flow. But the two physical bodies, both the spirit one and the physical one, have limitations of how fast that can occur, and the speed of which that occurs will depend on what happens and how rapid the change is. But I wouldn't be surprised if it happens over the course of a year or a few years, you know, where all of a sudden. So what I'm hoping, like I said earlier, that I hope to be able to give the mathematical formula for the union state and this condition in that state, but you know, my ability to do so depends totally upon my brain's capacity to absorb that information, and that while I've still got this, is going to have a deep struggle to absorb that. Does that make sense? Yep. So what's happening for me is that as I change and grow, there's new awarenesses developing all the time. I become newly aware of a lot of different things, most of which I don't get to share with you because I can't. Until you're able to absorb it, right? But I can continue growing and continue changing and new awarenesses developing, but at this point in time, like I'm 5% of probably 5% of what we will be then, or less. Does that make sense?
Yeah, cool, thank you.
Yeah. So what I'm regurgitating to you in terms of my memory is probably a few percentage points of what I remember, and in a lot of cases, like for me, it feels like not even a few percentage points, you know. So it's going to be difficult for anybody around us if that does happen, because obviously I'll start blabbering on about a whole heap of things that nobody understands, right? So in a condition of love, you'd obviously, you know, share information in a way that people can understand. But yeah, but that's a part of the process. Mary, you want to just mention the spirits, what they were saying to you about some of this? Might need to stand if that's
I'll
okay.
I'll stand up, yep. when you were talking about the rose-coloured
cord. Yeah.
The ones that were talking to me couldn't personally see it for themselves.
Yep.
And they were looking around the room and they couldn't see it for anyone.
Yep.
Except for yourself.
Yep.
And they're very intrigued
as
about
why it's coming out of me but not others.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes. And but you kind of answered the questions as to why. And
probably completely. Many of you here believe you've met your soulmate or you have a longing for your soulmate, and the reality is unless the spirit can see the cord coming out of you, you haven't. You're not aware. So what does that tell you? that it's all driven by other things. Yeah, addictions and so forth. Pretty confronting. Yeah. I've yet to meet a person that I've felt has a, maybe aside from my son Tristan, who has a real soulmate longing for the other half of themselves.
There's a lot of confusion about how we can have, it sounds like there's elements of the real self.
There are.
Which, so the feeling is that this soulmate longing, that must come from the real self, is
has
what
to,
they're
yes,
feeling.
Yes.
But then it's obvious that even with some people who have that, they have other issues that you've been talking about in the unloving self.
They do.
This is me paraphrasing.
Including myself, yep.
Yep. So there's a lot of confusion about how that happens.
Well,
how
it's a process of development, as we've said. So basically, as you develop more and more in love and therefore awareness and more in your feelings, and many of you are totally detuned from feelings at this point, really shutting down feelings, don't really know what your own feelings are, not really aware of what those feelings are, a lot of times engaging addictions as if they are feelings. When they're not, they're just codependent bartering systems to feed sucking vortexes or the sucking vortexes of others. And so you don't really know what a feeling is in many cases. You have to become aware of these feelings. And so that process, by the time a person reaches the fourth or fifth sphere in their development, they now have a lot of feelings that they are recognizing and aware of. And therefore, they can feel much more easily the feeling of longing for the other half of themselves as a feeling. And as a result of it being a feeling, there's the cord coming out of them. And then as a result of the cord coming out of them, you can easily trace where the other half is.
So the cord is dependent on having a feeling?
Yes.
A specific type of feeling?
Yes. Remember, we're in this state of separation because we've not allowed the rose cord, which is actually all about love for the other half of self. Many of us haven't allowed it because we haven't even been aware that it's there. Many of us don't allow it because of a whole heap of emotional injuries that we have, that we think we're allowing it, but actually we're just feeding a whole heap of addictions. And so many of us don't have that cord developed as a strong feeling. Now, any spirit who examines you can see what you have strong feelings about. And every one of those, so they can see the colours of all the cords coming out of you, many of which are very strong feelings you have coming out of you. But they're all addictive feelings. So they're all browns and blacks and greys and, you know, they're all, and some dirty oranges and, you know, a lot of dirty colour in it that they see. They are your very strong feelings, and the reason why they see them in colour is because they are intense inside of us, and that's what they see coming out of you. But they don't identify, they can't see the rose-coloured colour because that feeling is not coming out of you. It's not undeveloped. It's yet to be developed as a feeling. Does that make sense to everyone? And so from a spirit's perspective, he examines the room and he goes, but nobody has that. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It just means that nobody in the room has that developed yet. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And honestly, I don't see many people the whole world over who have it developed.
That's what they told me.
Yeah.
That they did not realise it identifies you as someone bright, that you having it, but they didn't realise what the specific
feeling was. Yeah, which is a feeling for the other half. Yeah.
And it's more powerful than any feeling that they, in their current, they're like in the third and below spheres, it's more powerful than any feeling they've seen coming out of anyone.
Yeah.
And has a different quality.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And colour, obviously. And the colour is very distinct. And just trying to find somebody's shirt or something that is similar to the colour, but it's probably, not really.
Dirty colour.
No, it's not dirty. Like, the rose-coloured colour is a very clean, crisp colour. No one here has it being worn on them or anything. It's sort of a bit like, that colour there, I suppose. But it's hard to. I know you can't see that, but that's that light, tiny little colour. That's anyway. Yeah. Anyway, is that what they wanted to ask me?
There's more questions about soulmates.
Sure. Hope you don't mind us asking some spirit questions.
Why do I want to reject the idea of becoming one entity with common feelings and thoughts so much? Mm. Why do I so strongly want to retain my idea of myself in this body?
Yeah, good question, huh? This is our main problem, is that we want to, and the main, the answer to it primarily is that we are addicted to the concept that we don't have to consider someone else. Mm. We're addicted to it. We want our whole concept of things is, I want to be able to determine for myself my own life and my own actions. I want to be able to choose who the other half of me is. I want to determine everything about my life, including who the other half of me actually is. And this particular feeling of self-determination, which is a self-reliant feeling based upon, many times, upon pain and addiction, is driving us to remain separate from our other half. And so when we walk into a room, a person who has their soulmate feeling open, when they walk into a room, the first most dominant feeling they feel in a room is the feeling of how the genders are so separate to each other and all of the intergender emotional injuries that cause these separations. Right? And one of the primary emotional injuries that cause a separation is this feeling that I want to determine for myself my life and not be influenced or not and not trust anybody else in the process, and definitely not trust that God knows better than I do how I'm going to be happy. Right? So that feeling of self-determination rather than reliance on God is one of the primary causes of the separation. Mm. Make sense to them?
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Yeah.
The struggle is that it's an intense feeling that they dislike the confrontation between what you're saying and how it makes them feel.
Yes, because what they feel is terrified at that point. Their feelings like, so you're basically saying, and I am basically saying, that you, as one half of your soul, are not going to determine the rest of your existence. That's what I'm saying. That means I'm basically saying that whoever is the other half of you is also going to have a part determining your future. And for most of you, that feels many of you feel very angry about that, actually. And in fact, many of you are very angry about the concept of soulmates, even though you have addictions about it. You know, you have some addictions about, you know, needing another person and wanting another person in your life and, you know, these kind of things, but you're very angry about it. Yeah.
Yep. That's good.
Let yourself feel your anger about it and work your way through it emotionally. We go to Ange.
Yeah, sure. Can you talk a little bit about the connection and the communication between soul halves?
Well, all communication between the two halves of the soul, and it's not even right, is it, to call it the two halves of the soul, because it's really one soul that just is unaware of its other half, right? But all communication between the two halves of the soul is emotional.
Yeah.
So it's all about emotions, desires. In the Paget messages, we call them passions for that reason. Does that make sense? Passions, you think of passionate desire, you know, passions. Longings, etc. Those are all, like, aspirations are all a part of the soul. And all of those are communicated emotionally, not intellectually. It's like when myself and Mary are joined together, I'll feel things, and she, as I'm feeling it, will multiply the feeling of it. If it begins in the male part of the soul, it'll be multiplied by the female part of the soul. And if it begins in the female part of the soul, it'll be multiplied by the male half of the soul. It won't be resisted. Every time you resist it, and this is why many of you have got to learn to feel your longings, passions and desires and emotions, because every time you resist it, you're actually refusing the other half of yourself, as well as refusing yourself, your real self. You're obviously refusing your half as well, but you're also refusing the other half. So in other words, you're refusing the whole self by refusing to have emotions, refusing to have desires, refusing to have passions. This is why people who have had passions but who have developed their passions in the wrong direction often find the other half of themselves sooner than having passion, those who decide to not have passions at all, or not have emotions at all, or to detune from emotions. That makes sense? And many of us have got to learn to have emotions and desires and passions and to really feel what they are. Now, obviously, at this stage, the majority of our emotions and desires and passions are not actually emotions, desires and passions. They're really just addictions, right? Which is not the same as having an emotion, desire and passion that's in harmony with love in any way, but rather they are emotions that are out of harmony with love, so they will be destructive to the joining of the soul. And it's the emotions that are in harmony with love. And one other aspect, so we want to focus on two aspects with regard to the joining of the soul. The first emotion, one is emotion, which I use as a blanket term to describe emotions, desires, passions, longings and those things. And the second thing is the other tool. Remember, these are two tools, right? Truth. You cannot have a facade-based relationship with the other half. You just can't. It's not going to work, right? You'll be living in facade if you try it, and you're never going to develop your soul. You won't recognize who the true I is or anything like that as a part of the process. So these have to be truthful. In other words, if we need to add some words to this, don't we? Basically, we call them sincere and truthful, loving emotions, desires, passions and longings. Right, so in answer to Andrew's question, if I have emotions, desires, passions and longings in harmony with sincere and truthful loving desires, then that automatically opens me to the other half of myself. So this tells me, doesn't it, that if I have an emotion and I'm honest about it, that's going to help me connect to my soulmate more, even if the emotion is out of harmony with love, because this aspect of truth is at least happening, right? So I can start actually developing a connection with the other half of myself even just by developing the tool of truth inside of myself as an aspiration. That automatically starts my connection with the other half of self. You get that? But if I avoid the truth, now my emotions are disconnected. So assuming that my emotions were already disconnected, my emotions are disconnected and truth is disconnected, what hope have I got to connect to the other half? The answer is none. You're going to be in a complete state of unawareness, lack of awareness of the other half. You're going to be constantly asking yourself, is this person my soulmate? Is this person my soulmate? Without knowing, because you can't feel and you're not in a state of truth with them anyway. So you're just in a state of facade. So of course they are not going to be able to recognize you very easily, or you them. Now, if one half of the soul gets into a state of truth and is open emotionally, they can recognize the other half. Whether the other half is totally blocked down emotionally and totally in a facade. Because at the soul level, they've opened up the pathway of feeling the truth from the other half, feeling the emotions from the other half, recognizing that that is the nature and personality that they personally also have. We going far away here now, or what? So go. Can we go to Raj next to you, Ange? He's right next to you. Thanks.
Jesus, on this scale here, if I'm a bit confused over the real self. So if I work my way all the way through this and I clear the terror and I start to reduce the pain, do I start to, I can understand that I would be living in a much more loving state, but do I start to find my real self?
Are you living in a much more loving state, or are you just not living in as much unloving state?
Well, I'm not living in such an unloving state.
Correct.
Right. But I still haven't found my real self.
And you still haven't developed your real self. But it's highly unlikely this would be the case, but because we'll talk about this in the next few days. But the reality is, if I removed all of that without developing any part of my real self, without wanting to recognize my real self, which is going to be hard to do, but if I did do that, it still doesn't mean that I'm guaranteed to know who my real self is or anything like that.
Right.
I have to develop a will. Connect to my real self.
Right. And if I develop my will in the process of going through that.
Yeah, which you will do generally. Right. Like when you work through some of the blockages, your will is more exposed.
Right.
As you reduce your fears, often your desires also start increasing, right?
Yeah, that's what I want to do.
And as your desires start increasing, now we're talking about these, huh?
Right.
Because they're in harmony with love. So therefore now I'm getting some desire that I didn't recognize before. I'm recognizing the desire. I'm acting upon it. I'm not in fear with it. So therefore I'm taking action. And as a result of that, I'm becoming more like, it's almost like a natural process once you remove a lot of the things that stop you from being you. And this has a big bearing on that. Yep. Most of you don't realize this yet, but this fear is to a large part about not being you. You don't actually at this stage want to be you. You want to be someone other than you because you're so freaked out about what the world's going to do to you when you're you. You follow me? There's a lot of fear about
absolutely.
That.
Right, so it's a bit like the taking something out of the bottle and being able to fill it up with the desires and the passions.
Yeah, and obviously if you tip out a bit, then there's capacity to receive, isn't there? So it's obviously going to look more like a gradual process, isn't it? Rather than remove all of this and then you have a little bit of that sort of thing. It's more like a gradual process as you get rid of some of these things, and particularly once you get to here. This is when you start. Most of you are freaked out about being the real you. This is your primary fear. Like this is your terror. So the terror, once that's addressed, you can see you're no longer afraid of being the real you. And so now you're willing to explore who the real you is, right? But at this stage, for the majority of you, you're not willing to even explore it because you're so far in the addiction, and the addiction's all about avoiding the terror of who you really are, you see?
The irony of it.
So the irony of it is that a lot of this has happened, and there's a reason why that's happened, and it's quite obvious if you think about it. Most parents want their child to become what the parent defines as what the child should be. Now, most children are attracted to their parents to confront what the parent is in, how the parent is in error. So there is usually a wide discrepancy between what the parent wants the child to become and what the child actually is from a personality perspective that God created. And it's purposefully designed to confront the parent's error. You follow? But what do the parent do? The parent does, it suppresses the child's personality and nature, suppresses their real self. It causes them to go into lies and therefore into facade. And as a result of that, the child loses itself. So by the time the child has become an adult, its primary fear is to be itself. Because in that process, it's lost itself. Does everyone get that? And so one of your, like, when you say to me things like, I'm afraid of what the world's going to do, you're only afraid of what the world's going to do if you be yourself. You're not afraid of what the world's going to do if you conform to the world. If you conform to the world's probably going to accept you, right? So there's nothing to be afraid of then. So you see that a lot of your fear is about being the real you. And the reason why is because that fear was heavily established in your childhood right from before birth for most of you. It was already established. Your parents had a concept or idea of what they wanted you to become, and they spent a lot of their effort and time helping you become that. right? That's the damage of the facade. And the damage of the facade is all about getting away from who you really are, not letting you develop as you really are. And so what I see in most children is I can feel their real nature and also feel how much their parents are suppressing their real nature through their choices, right? And how much the parents want that. And I haven't met a parent yet who doesn't. They think they don't, but they all do, right? And so this development of the real you is severely curtailed by this dominant terror, which is if you're the real you, you won't survive. That's what you believe, which then triggers this whole denial of self thing. Well, you look at it, you look at it from a practical perspective, you can see that most parents are not happy with who you choose as a relationship unless they think that that person's a nice fella or a nice woman. They're not happy, right? They will express their unhappiness. Many go ballistic and some even murder, expressing their unhappiness about that issue. Worldwide, that happens frequently, actually, even today, where people get murdered because they've had a relationship with someone who the parents have disapproved of and so forth. So there's a huge amount of emotion projected at the child to not be their real self. Huge amount. So what happens then is the child learns that it's got to, if it's going to have any emotions or desires at all, they can't be sincere and truthful based on what they really want. They can only be based on what the parents want. That's all. That's all they'll allow themselves to have. And for many of you, that's what you, as adults, you're still only allowing yourself to have what your parents let you have. Or you're in rebellion against that, one of the two. And usually it's allowance on some issues and rebellion on the other, but there's not much love in either. Yeah. Anyway, let's
thank you.
Igor, if we go to Igor and so. Yeah, good question, Raj. So,
my question is about the what are the clues? How can we recognize the clues of our character that God gave us? And also, is there a law that governs our attraction on earth to a certain culture based on our character and nature?
There's all sorts of laws that govern where we incarnate into, of course, primarily defined by the laws involving what the parents need to confront, but also about what the society in that particular area needs to confront. But the question, Igor, is driven by a desire to jump ahead. What I'm basically saying to you is if you deconstruct a lot of this, then bits of your real self will start poking through. I've used that idea that imagine you've got a curtain there, and for the majority of you, the bits of your real self is like peeking out, you know, peeking out occasionally and looking at the world and going, that's all too scary, I'm not going to be my real self there. And what we do then is we project the facade in front of the curtain, so that's what everybody interacts with, the facade, the image, the projection of ourselves, which is really just this. To be our real selves, we've got to get ourselves out of this state of peeking out from behind the curtain at the world and actually step in to the world as our full person. But we're not going to do that while we're driven by all this, right? Now, as we're driven by all that, it's fairly unlikely we'll recognize our personality and our nature until we've deconstructed some of this, right? And particularly because this part here is driven by the fact that we don't want to be our real self. We're terrified of our real self. We're going to probably have to get to this to start recognizing who we really are, right? And actually get through it to recognize who we really are. And that's why, you know, for the majority of us, we can't see who we are right now as our personality and our nature. Because the terror is going, don't go there, don't go there, don't go there, never going to go there. Right? Basically what we want is we want it to be safe to be our real self. And in the world we live in, it's pretty unsafe to be your real self. That's what you think. So you're even going to have to get rid of some of your addictions to safety, addictions to control, addictions to wanting to have everybody like you, because if they don't like you, they'll attack you, and if they attack you, your survival is threatened. You're going to have to get rid of those addictions, because without, like, while those addictions remain, it's highly unlikely you will develop a will to be who you really are, or to even desire to know who you really are. You get that? You really just want the addictions met. The imperative of this terror is that don't be your real self. Don't be your real self. Be someone else other than your real self, because that's the one that's going to survive. Right? And God's saying, you're just killing your own happiness there. You're destroying your own self there. And we're going, oh, I don't care. Survival is more important to me than destroying myself, or seemingly destroying myself. In fact, God's designed a universe that we can't even destroy ourselves. Isn't that interesting? But we, because there's a law governing that. You can't even destroy yourself. Amazing, huh? But we believe we can. And we believe we can completely get rid of ourselves and replace ourselves with someone else. And we've done it. And we do it all the time. So this is a very important thing to understand, that unless you do that, the recognition of your personality and nature in this area, and even its development of your personality and nature, is going to be severely curtailed. And it's only the areas that your mother and father and society have allowed you to develop your personality in that will have been developed. Now, there's not a single person on the planet who hasn't been allowed to do something in a certain direction. It's very rare to meet one, I should say. You know, you have to have been tortured from the time of childhood onwards, generally, to not develop a part of some of your real self's nature, because most parents will accept some parts of it, depending on whether it challenges you or not, them or not. So the reality is, most of you have a little smidge of it developed, right? And that's the times, oftentimes, when you feel really good about doing something and really like it's done for a pure motivation and so forth. And that's often a part of the real self. But it's rare, because you're not allowed to go there with everything. And you're certainly not allowed to be truthful about it. Not allowed to be truthful about it. So what I'm suggesting is some of you, all of you actually have a part of your real self already as a part, mixed in with all this, that has actually been developed. But for the majority of us, it's very, like, it's of poor development. It hasn't been allowed to thrive. It hasn't been promoted. It's been suppressed to a large degree. And it's only the areas that have been either promoted or allowed that you'll recognize as a part of your real self at this stage. Does that make sense to you? Yeah. So it's a good question. If we go up to Alan on this side and Amber on this side.
How will I know whether it's just another addiction, that feeling of, you know, really feeling good about something that I'm doing?
Do you get angry when it's not fulfilled?
Okay.
It's really easy to recognize our addictions, remember? Do we feel really nice when it is fulfilled and then really angry when it's not? Well, the soul's real feelings and personality is not like that. It doesn't get angry or and when it's not, you know, allowed, and when it is allowed, doesn't feel all this comfort and satisfaction either. It feels true sense of joy and happiness. And on the other hand, it has no anger associated with it. So if you feel angry, then obviously it's been an addiction. It's really easy to know. You got to remember that. It's easy to know. Yeah.
Just with my next question, I'm a bit freaked out, but do the opposite halves of the soul, do they embody opposite qualities to complement each other, or the exact same qualities to amplify and, yeah.
Yeah, there's no such thing in God's, in this thing as opposites attract. It's another bunch of, what did I call the other one? Oh, it's so weird. But a lot of the opposites attract thing is about one person having one addiction and the other person having the opposite addiction, and the two persons get together because the two opposites are attracting, right? The reality is, at the soul level, you'll find you have the same God designed you to have the same personality and the same. So remember, personality is different to undeveloped, right? We'll talk about this later. So we got personality and nature, should we call it, our nature. Now, personality and nature are part of what God put into us as an expression of God, indicating to us a part of his nature. So in other words, we all have fragments of God's nature within us that God placed there purposefully. And God, being an infinite being, has the ability to put infinite fragments in an infinite number of beings. Does that make sense of God's personality and nature that God's implanted there? Now, for the majority of us, it's undeveloped, it's unrecognized, it's not acknowledged, right? This personality and nature can be developed, of course, and will be developed as you develop your soul, so it becomes stronger and stronger and stronger, but it will be in the case of a male-female based sort of, where predominantly one side is feminine and one side is masculine, it's going to be one side expressing the male part of that nature and personality, right? And one part expressing the female part of that nature and personality. In the case of a soul where the halves incarnate into bodies that are more like evenly dispersed, where there's an even dispersal of, in other words, a highly dominant male soul, will have two male halves, and therefore they will be dominantly masculine in the expression of their personality. Does that make sense? And there's all the ranges in between, right? To two female, or dominantly female expression of their personality.
Did you mean a homosexual couple just then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's all still the expression of the personality and nature of the individual. And the personality and nature of the two halves is going to be pretty much identical. Interesting, isn't it? You'll find it, actually. And you know what you finish up doing? You finish up falling in love with yourself. You think it's so wonderful you've met another half that's like you and thinks like you and feels like you. And isn't it wonderful? You got just this other half of yourself that's like yourself, that thinks like you, feels like you, about all these different things, has the same desire, same passion, and you can share everything. Like, can you see how wonderful that would be? And it doesn't mean you condemn other people for having a different nature or personality. It's just this one special, well, that's special because of the other half of you, right? So they're special in that regard. And it's just like, yeah, there's this constant flow of development of nature and personality in that place. And it's really beautiful, actually, to experience. And most of you sort of don't understand how good it is, because otherwise you wouldn't be so freaked out about it, right? It's so good to experience that feeling of your feelings being multiplied and amplified by the other half's feelings and so forth. So, you know, what do we see in today's definition of relationships? It's all about compromise. You know, like, oh, goodness me. It's like, I've got to compromise this so that I can get along with you there. And so, you know, oh, you've got to compromise that. And what do we call it? We call it a, you know, it's a live and let live situation, or what's the other words we use for it in relationships? A give and take in a relationship, you know, as if anything in to do with love is ever a take. But anyway, so we call it all these things because we don't believe it is possible to have another half having exactly the same concepts, exactly the same ideas, and exactly the same desires as we do, just a different type of expression depending on how much the masculinity or femininity part of it is developed, right? And we don't imagine that to be even a good thing, some of us. But if you think about it, wouldn't it be wonderful? You never compromise. And this is why truth is so important. Truth is about not compromising on the real desires and passions of the soul, right? So the only way you're going to draw the other half of yourself to you is to not compromise with regard to truth, not compromise with regard to what love is, not compromise about the expression of your personality and nature, because that's how the other half of you is attracted to you. You follow? Yeah. And what do most of us do instead of that? We're too busy doing this to even know what, you know, and we go, what do they want from me? I'll do that. That's not going to attract you to the other half. You go, what do I feel in this matter? What part of my feelings is in harmony with love and truth? Because that's what I need to act on. Any feelings that are out of harmony with love and truth that I can recognize must be to do with this pain. I need to get rid of it so that I can get down to really pure, in a pure way, express my nature and personality. Does that make sense? Very much the same way of feeling, same way of thinking, masculine and feminine, in particular, the degrees of masculinity and femininity will be expressed. Things will be expressed differently, but you sort of feel like each one of you is enabling the other person's loving behavior. It's very hard to describe as a feeling, but it is an immensely satisfying experience.
Yeah.
To have another person in this universe that is the direct expression of yourself reflected back to you and amplifying your own feelings and emotions.
Yeah. I've always been repelled by people who remind me of myself.
Yeah. See, most people are. And I see, you know, I see relationships developing either through codependent or addiction or by this fear of self. You know, the other person reflecting self, and so you choose to not be with them because they too much like you, you say. You know, or they remind you of you and you don't like you. Right? And all of this stops. It's just, yeah, honestly, it's such a wonderful place to be. I really don't understand why nobody likes it on Earth. You know, it's just like, yeah, most people on Earth don't like that place at all. And a lot of it's about control. You know, a lot of it's about, you know, there's a lot of desires on Earth for the individual to control their circumstance, situation, rather than submitting to this beautiful thing that God's created, which is a real relationship. Right, all other relationships don't, you know, even if it's the reality is you can do some of that with another person who's not your soulmate, but the reality also is that unless they're your soulmate, they will end up having desires, passions and feelings that are different to yours because their desires, passions and feelings will be in line with their soulmate and your desires, passions and feelings will be in line with yours. Does that make sense? So it feels to me when you guys want to decide who that is for yourself, I just go, why do you want to think that your decision's better than God's? I don't get that either. It's almost like saying, oh, God didn't know enough about this. God didn't know enough about this, so I'm going to decide to, you know, be someone different and choose someone different because I'll be happier like that. And I'm going, what? God knows what's going to make you happy the most, you know. And it's wonderful having this nature and personality, and the more you combine, the more powerfully everyone around you experiences your true nature and personality. So the more you combine, the stronger and stronger it gets. And so the people who know us in the spirit world don't see myself and Mary as separate beings, and they don't feel us as separate beings either. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does, actually. Kind of.
We feel like one person to them.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, well, 3 minutes over, guys. So do we want to keep going with the questions or you want to... If we go to Nikki, maybe. Sorry, not Nikki. Get too mixed up. Sorry, Seth. And Justin, maybe. Sorry, Seth.
Hi, Jesus. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about how the... a half of the soul making unloving choices negatively affecting the happiness of the whole. Does that mean that
making an unloving choice?
Yes.
Yeah.
So does that mean that when I feel my soul automatically feels the compensatory effects of my other half, the other half of myself making unloving choices, and vice versa?
Yes, well, it's a number of ways, Cecilia, but maybe maybe sometimes it's easier to understand it in its extreme. So I'll give you an extreme case, okay. Right? this soul is capable of a union state, which, as you can imagine, must be a pretty blissful state for the both halves. It's capable of that bliss, but it's only capable of that bliss if both halves engage the desire for the bliss and both halves work through their own limitations, refuse that, and both halves receive God's love. Now, let's say one half decides to not receive God's love.
Okay.
Now, can you see now the whole soul is now incapable of the bliss?
Yep.
Because one half is preventing the bliss from ever occurring. This is why when you read the pageant messages, you hear the soulmate say to their partner, I need to be with you for my happiness. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. They recognize that the bliss is not going to be able to be developed further without the other half being with them. Right. So that's an extreme case of where one half can exercise its will to reject God and therefore not allow the full bliss, the union condition, to ever occur.
Okay.
Right. Now, it also happens in much smaller ways too. For example, if you have an emotion, an addiction, let's say you have, that a man who loves you has to care for you. Let's say you just have that one addiction, mm-hmm. which most women on the planet have, right? And whether it be financially or just in terms of protection, you know, like the man stands up for you, he's violent with anybody who gets violent with you and so forth, right? He protects you. Yeah. It's just that one addiction. Now, that one addiction is driven by unloving behavior, right? Unloving demands, unloving desires, which obviously we'd need to release at some point. But let's say we have it. And let's say the other half of the soul has a feeling that he is not ever going to meet one of your addictions, which is actually the true state of his sincere and truthful loving emotions, desires and passions will be to never meet one of your addictions. So if he knows that you have an addiction, which he will know because if he's sensitive, he'll know you have an addiction to him, for him to protect you and even act violently for you, and he is refusing to meet that addiction, how are you going to feel? You're going to feel, he's a bit of a bastard. You know, he's a terrible man. I don't want him. I want someone who's going to meet my addictions and protect me, you know. That's how you will feel. Yeah. That will naturally create a separation between the two halves and therefore a lower state of happiness.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So it happens all the time where we're constantly, our addictions in particular, determine. But even our choices, remember the first example I gave you, just the two removing all their addictions but one making a choice for God and the other one not, is going to have a severe effect on the happiness of both halves.
Yeah, okay. Yep. So it also means that the other half could be in a higher state of awareness than me at this stage.
Correct, they could be.
Wow.
Yeah.
I had never imagined that. That's very
arrogant. They could be, yeah. And they could be like in prison in the hills, couldn't they?
Okay.
And they could have warts and all over them and, you know, they could, in other words, be physically distorted because of the different things that have happened to them, but it still won't change how you feel about them once you open up to the other half. But see, many of you are going to have to let go of your favourite concept of who a masculine being, a perfect masculine being or perfect feminine being is. And do you know what your concept currently is predominantly? It's daddy or mummy. That was your ideal. Oh, sad, eh? But it's true. If you think about it, all the people you've looked at in the past, it's either rebellion against daddy or an acceptance of daddy in that person. One of the two. And the same goes with mummy. It's rebellion against mummy or acceptance of mummy. One of the two. And so at this stage, the majority of you are completely, and it makes sense if you think about what we've learnt about the facade and the soul, doesn't it, and pain. Because most of our pain has come from our family of origin. You know, that's how it got created, particularly our facade. So it makes sense that for the majority of you, you have a concept related to perfect mummy, perfect daddy, and that's who you're attracted to. You're going to have to give that up because you don't know what your soulmate's going to look like. You don't know what they're going to feel like. You don't know what condition they're in. You don't know what state they're in terms of love or lack of love. You don't know. And what does that feel like? All my control just goes out the window. And of course, because all my control is out the window, I'm now angry. Because why do I control? To get addictions met. I'm now angry. I'm angry about the concept, soulmates. I'm angry about the way God's made it. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
How are we going time? I think I'm pretty over time, aren't I? Oh no, 10 minutes. Justin, we're up to. Are you okay to go? Well, like, we're going to head into 20 minutes over time in a minute. So,
Justin. You said that. So, when you have two, we'll say male halves.
Yep.
And so, from.
For that to occur, let's explain how that occurs. Firstly, for that to occur, the whole soul must be dominantly masculine.
Yep. So, that whole soul is dominantly masculine.
Yep.
And from what I've sort of. What I understand is that, like, homosexual men are quite soft and more emotionally sensitive.
No, but you're seeing the facade of many homosexual men most of the time. And if you talk to homosexual men properly, you'll find that a lot of them are actually like masculine men, with the exception there's a few feminine traits, but they're often quite masculine men. In fact, most homosexual men are very attracted to masculine men. Which is natural because the other half of their soul is masculine.
Oh, okay. Where I was going with that is...
See, our understanding even of the flawed state in either heterosexuality or homosexuality is actually quite distorted by injury.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. But go on with the question.
Sorry, where I was going with that was... because I was of the understanding or the impression that they were generally... sort of softer. As a heterosexual man, as I develop my masculinity, will I become softer, like I was assuming?
No, because the feminine qualities, in a homosexual couple, if depending on if feminine or masculine, doesn't matter, you've basically got the whole soul is dominantly, let's say it's masculine, dominantly masculine, right? Then of course the two halves split, they're going to be dominantly masculine but with some feminine traits. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And as a result, there will be dominant masculinity with some feminine traits, and they'll only be attracted to another man who has dominant masculinity with some feminine traits. But with you, when you split with your half, you're more dominantly masculine and your other half's going to be more dominantly feminine. And the total soul is going to be quite neutral when it comes to masculinity and femininity. Sure. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. And so you have ranges of the total soul that go from like almost 100% masculine to almost 100% feminine for the whole soul. And then, of course, the splits vary in between that range.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Okay. Should we keep going? No. No, I feel I need to get on to the next subject because the next subject is just as important as this. So that's given us... So we're 10 minutes late, so let me just work this out. Can we come back at 20 past 2? Is that right? Is it 20? Yeah, 20 past 2. Is that okay? Yep. Thanks, guys. Thank you.